And welcome live to Texas Motor Speedway and the NASCAR Busch Series presented by Old Spice. Thanks for your patience and those fans that have gathered here, over 200,000 expected tomorrow, maybe 100,000 or so here today to see a race on the Great American Track. And speed will be an issue here. Of course, danger always a part of things. The most cautions in a Busch Series race, 8 here back in 1997. No fewer than 5 cautions in a Texas Busch Series race. Right now, let's go down track side as we get ready to go. Steve Burns.
Chris, with the points leader, Greg Biffle, starting 11th. Greg, tell us about this race today with this long rain delay.
Well, I tell you, the track's changed a whole bunch since all the rain we've got. But we made some changes on the car. And we were pretty fair and happy hours, so I think we'll be okay. Going to be a long race, though.
300 miles, drivers starting in the front row have won the last 3 Busch Series races. And you just heard from Greg Biffle, who is your points leader. Jeff Green on the pole, currently running second. Rookie Jeff Hammond, Scott Riggs is 9.
I'm telling you right now, they've really got an awesome group right there. And Scott, in my opinion, I love watching Scott Riggs run.
Part of the story, of course, of Greg Biffle, as we talked about all day and has been talked about for the last couple of weeks, Kevin Harvick running in his second Busch race of this year. Jeff Burton, who has won a Busch Series race of this year, has not yet won on the Winston Cup race at Dublin, as he will be racing in tomorrow's Samsung Radio Shack 500. We're just about ready to go here at the Texas Motor Speedway. 13 drivers competing in their first Texas Busch Series race, so anything can happen. Hang on for 300 miles of fun. Time now for the invocation.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you that you manifest it to us in so many different ways. Today, we ask that you would show us this through your grace, your mercy, and your guidance. We thank you for these fans, for these teams, these sponsors, and for Texas. We ask that you'd bless us all with a great race. We thank you for Jesus, and we pray in his name, amen.
Please remain standing as Darren Keenum from the U.S. Air Force Band of the West brings us our national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
The drivers and crews ready to go, and we will be ready to go. The command in just a few moments. It looks like a terrific crowd on hand has braved the weather and the near 4-hour delay here at the Texas Motor Speedway. One of the fastest tracks on the circuit, Jeff Hammond. And what kind of race with Jeff Green on the pole and, of course, Greg Biffle leading in points at this time in the Busch Series. What should we expect in this race today?
I believe early on, Chris, you'll be looking at probably a follow the leader type deal, and hopefully these guys are going to be very, very patient and understand it. They got 300 miles, green racetrack, a lot of unknowns, but patience will be a premium.
All right, and this track repaved after the June races last year with the weather and the change. Now, even if it's dried out, how will that affect things and the way drivers will handle themselves?
Again, it's going to be one of those situations where if you're on the outside, you got to be patient and let somebody give you a hold to get down to the inside of the racetrack. Everybody knows that the low groove today is going to be the fast way around and probably the only way around early on. As we go on into the race, we should see that start to move up as they get more rubber on the racetrack. Then they can get a little more aggressive. Probably you'll see a lot of these guys be, you know, kind of like a little timid until they get through the first stop, as far as pit stops concerned, and make adjustments on their cars, and they'll get better as the day goes on.
And we're anxious to get this underway, and thanks for staying with us here on Fox. The guys who are the voices of Fox Racing, let's go upstairs. Darrell Waltrip, Larry McReynolds, and Mike Choi. Gentlemen.
Thanks, Chris. Hi, everybody. And patience, thank you at home for your patience. We've all been patiently waiting for the command that's about to be given. Now, Darrell, you've got a green racetrack. You know, you haven't had a lot of practice here. No. You got a new pavement. You got a fast racetrack.
Yeah.
Are you concerned?
Well, here's the thing about the Busch guys. Now, see, they haven't had a lot of laps on the track anyway. So, unlike the Cup guys that'll get to race on the track after these guys get finished today, the track will be a little different for them. So, they just got to be cautious. They can't go down in here, and there's a lot of guys in this series, folks, that don't understand the word cautious. They need to use the Jimmy Spencer philosophy and not forget that this is a one-lane racetrack, a one-groove racetrack right now, and take a little bit of time to get another groove worked in.
Larry, how are you going to keep your driver on the bottom of the racetrack all day here?
Well, I mean, you've got to make the right adjustments, and this is a 200-lap race. Track position is going to be so important. I almost believe that the outcome of this race could be determined right on pit road, who gets them off pit road in a hurry and who makes those right adjustments, especially on that last pit stop.
And here's something that's critical. You've got to, if you're starting on the outside, the start's going to be a big deal. You got to get to the inside. You've got to talk to the guy just on your inside on the front of you and just on the inside to the rear of you. Talk to the spotter, talk to the driver, say, cut me some slack. Let me get down in front of you. I'll let you pass me back once we get going. So there's some deals being made right now as we speak.
Spotter could be the most critical guy on the race team today on top of this grandstand.
That could well be the case. All right, we're getting close to a start. Here is Kevin Harvick's car. And Darrell, what's that sign say inside?
Oh, no, he's
DW, you don't want none of this? Bring it, old timer.
I love it. I got something for you, old buddy. You just wait.
He's got Sonic. You got Supersonic.
Oh, yeah.
You're going to show him next week.
I got the Duckhead Dodge.
Wait a minute. You got Hammond, though.
And I got Hammond. Oh, and
it's almost like having a restrictor plate.
I got five crew chiefs. I got Hammond. I got Dean Johnson. I got Corey Stott. I got Larry. He can't deal with me.
Folks, Darrell's going to drive. He's going to put his helmet back on, drive in the truck race at Martinsville next Saturday. That's what all this kidding back and forth is about.
And they asked me, do I have to run a yellow bumper? And I said, I don't know. My whole truck's yellow.
Yellow? How about like gold or, you know, whatever the – what's the AARP color?
Hey, listen. Now, Joy, don't you start on me.
Jumped on the bandwagon too.
I'm with you. I'm a partner here.
Come on, man. We're tight.
That's right.
I thought she was going to clean my window for me.
I'll do that.
I got a brand new prescription windshield. I think it's going to work great.
Bifocals.
I'll be there with a squeegee.
Attaboy.
All right. Dick Bergeron.
Well, when the green flag drops, keep your eye on number 87, Joe Nemechek. He will be starting on the outside of the front row. Just two starts so far this year. He started on the pole at Daytona. Looked like a winner, but boom, the engine failed on him. He was the very first guy out. They kind of missed the setup at Las Vegas, but he is loaded for bear. Lost his Winston Cup ride. This is all he has right now. He's got a lot that he wants to show here at Texas this afternoon. Steve Burns.
Well, Dick, we just heard Larry McReynolds say that this race could very well be won or lost on pit road. Jeff Green won the Busch Series race 2 weeks ago at Bristol, and since then, his pit crew has been practicing twice a day, 6 a.m. and 6 p.m., to improve their stops. That's how badly they want to win this race here at Texas. Matt?
Well, Steve, here in the two-pit of Johnny Sutter, they spent the final practice session yesterday afternoon working on scuff tires, meaning putting a heat cycle through a brand new set of tires. Now, they scuffed in four sets of tires, and then after happy hour, he and his crew chief, Ricky Vire, sat down, and they went over the comments from each set of tires, and they narrowed down the three sets that they want to run today because teams are allowed three sets of tires under caution. So they narrowed down the three sets they feel like are the best for their race car, and they have that four set as a backup. Guys?
Still a little work being done down in turns one and two. This racetrack is built in an area with a very high water table. It's a former cotton field, and there are a couple little bit of standing water there at the edge of the racetrack. And if you're going to take race cars in there at 180 miles an hour, cars with tires with slick tread, you need that track to be really dry. So they're taking a couple extra minutes down there.
Mike, it's 190 miles an hour. I mean, we did.
That's right. The slowest speed in the middle of the corner is 180.
180 miles. Right. So you got to have the track dry, and the driver's got to have the confidence there.
I think we're just minutes away from the start of the O'Reilly Auto Parts 300 here in Texas. So thanks for your patience. We'll be right back and get this going on Fox.
In Winston Cup and Busch, and Winston Cup regulars have won four of the five Busch Series races this season. We've waited a long time for this, so these words are going to sound real nice.
Real good.
Ladies and gentlemen, direct your attention here in the Victory Circle area as we have Joe Pollock from O'Reilly's with us for those words.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
Let's go back up to the top. Let's go racing.
Thanks for hanging in here with us on our marathon telethon. NASCAR Busch Racing on Fox. Let's go upstairs, the guys who will call the race. Darrell Waltrip, Larry McReynolds, and Mike Joy. Guys,
listen to that sound. That's music.
That'll scare those clouds away.
You know, the only one, though, that I don't think has quite the sound he'd like to have is possibly Jason Keller in the 57 car. The hood is up right now on his car, and the NASCAR officials are there with his crew.
And you know, Mike, there's an old theory, and it's an old theory, trust me. Dick Beatty used to believe this, and he's the past director of a NASCAR competition. Once we got the cars running, and you got some turbulence, like a vortex almost, that it would open up the skies and the rain would stay away. So I've seen it happen.
I believe in it.
I believe it too. Yeah. I've seen it happen. If we get the cars down the track, get them going, I believe it'll push the clouds away.
When I first described that on network TV, that vortex theory, everybody looked at me like a huh?
Yeah.
But it seems to work.
I'm telling you, I've seen
it. Today will be a true test of it.
I've seen the rain stay away, and when the car stopped, immediately it started raining.
Here we go with the starting lineup. Jeff Green, 20th career pole. Joe Nemechek, Johnny Sauter, a rookie, and Jimmy Spencer right there in the second row. Matt Kenseth, second here 2 years ago with defending race winner Kevin Harvick. Jack Sprague, fourth in the points with the Rockingham winner Jason Keller. Bobby Hamilton Jr., second straight top 10 start. And Stacy Compton, he's had a great season. Greg Biffle, rookie Scott Riggs. Biffle's the point leader. Jeff Purvis, Randy LaJoie, two-time series champ. Jamie McMurray, one of 11 drivers under age 25 there with Larry Foyt, who's another one. Todd Bodine and Shane Meal, who is 21. Jeff Burton, he's had a great season so far. And Mike Wallace. Lyndon Amick, Kevin Grubb. Well, you've already met all these folks. We've interviewed them all today, I think. Kerry Earnhardt, Hank Parker Jr., Kenny, Let's Make a Deal Wallace, and Ken Schrader. There's Michael Walter back in the 14th row with Tony Raines, Young Guns, Casey Mears, and Scott Wimmer. Ashton Lewis Jr. and the youngest driver in the field, 20-year-old Stuart Kirby.
Yeah, he's a good little kid. He's from Bowling Green, Kentucky. And Larry Carter, my old crew chief on the 66 car, is working for Spencer. He's his crew chief. Expect a lot of good things out of this kid eventually.
Saw Stedman Marlin there, Sterling's son, going off 35th.
Another young gun there, the young kid that's, you know, coming into the from a racing family. Cuckoo Marlin, Sterling's dad, Sterling, and now Stedman out there racing. Just a NASCAR tradition, carrying on a family tradition.
Everybody at the ready. Let's go to Steve Burns.
And Mike, we've caught up with Steve Addington, the crew chief on the 57. Steve, what happened to the race car?
When he went to crank it up, the clutch pedal went to the floor like it blew a seal out of the throwout bearing or something. We're just going to have to try to do this without a clutch.
And just to follow up on that, yeah, what they have, they actually have a hydraulic clutch. It's not the mechanical clutch with the normal Z-bar like you would expect, but it's a hydraulic clutch that works off a hydraulic system that goes to the throwout bearing.
And what can happen is it can get air in the system, just like your brakes.
And you have to bleed it just like a brake system.
So I think if it's, I've seen it cure itself, believe it or not. You can pump the pedal and that air will go away and you got a clutch.
Today's race analysis brought to you by Dr. Scholes.
43 cars for 200 laps, 300 miles. And the pit window, think we'll get 65 laps?
I'm going to go along with what we heard some of the crew chiefs say. I do believe that NASCAR maybe get 20, 30 laps into this race with this racetrack being this green, no rubber on the racetrack. They may throw a caution and let everybody look at their tires.
And today's weather, 51 degrees, the humidity at least 80%, winds out of the southeast at 12. And there's a little bit of light sky up there, not quite blue sky, but you can see they're off in the distance, pretty good. Dr. Scholes, look, feel, do better. We're getting set to go racing here. A few extra pace laps, make sure things are totally dry out on the track. Last lap for the jet dryers. Be set to go.
The track temperature is 64 degrees. That's about 15 to 20 degrees cooler than what it was yesterday when these guys did get their final practice set.
That would worry me. I mean, the track temperature that cold. I know these tires are on the conservative side as far as being too soft or too hard. I got to believe they're on the conservative side toward being too hard with all the unknowns. The first few laps of this race, got to really be careful with the track conditions the way they are. Cold temperatures, hard tires could cause the guys a problem.
The field is split in half, a pace car leading each half, so drivers can measure their tachometer readings at pit roads and pace lap speed.
And why they did that, Mike, is because when all 43 of us were on top of each other, you couldn't get a good accurate pit road speed. So they split the field in half, two pace cars. That way you get a better reading on what your tachometer should say when you come onto pit road.
John Darby, who is the Winston Cup director and last year served as Busch Series director, going up to have a look in the banking at what we call one of the weepers, an area where groundwater will seep out just onto the racetrack. That's Mike Helton, NASCAR president, in the rain gear.
Obviously, I think there's some concern. You don't want to send these cars again, hard tires, no rubber on the track. We cannot send these cars off in the first turn with water running out of the track.
And just to follow up, the pit road speed is 45 miles an hour. Depending on what rear end gear you have, that will be about 3,700 or 3,800 RPMs in second gear.
And normally you can hear the spotters going back and forth. And Larry, that's some more of those good notes I know you got over there. You probably even know what gear ratio they have in second gear.
Past the condos at turn two. You know, when Burton Smith first had the idea to build condominiums at the Speedway, it was at Charlotte Motor Speedway. They wanted like $85,000 a piece, and everybody went, condo? Who'd want to live with all that noise? Who'd want to live right at the racetrack? That's the silliest thing I ever heard. There's one in the real estate book this week. Danny Edwards was telling me $500,000.
You know who could have had the first one? I won the World 600. They just finished them. It's a Speedway Club number 001, and I had the option to buy the first condo at the Speedway Club, and I laughed. I told Bruton, I said, nobody's ever going to buy a condo at a racetrack.
Well, they're buying them at Charlotte, at Atlanta, and here at Texas. All those folks up on the roof and out at the balcony, they're ready to go racing.
Standing in line to buy them now.
Yeah, well, that's because I always like to buy high and sell low myself.
In that case, let's make a deal. Here's Matt.
Well, Mike, DW and Larry were talking about pit road speed, and when Johnny Sauter in the two car came on and said he was 4,300 RPMs in first gear, Bobby Hutchins, who is the head engineer at RCR, came on the radio and said, are you sure that you were in first gear? Because the 29 car, Kevin Harvick, was 4,100 in second, and the 21 car of Jeff Green was also different. But Green has a different transmission. But they asked Johnny just to make sure he was indeed in first. Yep, I was in first.
All right. Couple extra laps here again to make sure the track is completely dry and ready to race. You see there on the roll bar, DW, you don't want none of this. Bring it, old timer. That is in Kevin Harvick's car. Darrell, you gonna stand for that?
Hey, hot dog Harvick. Hot dog Harvick, are you there? You know, this is DW up here, and I just want you to know this old dog still got some bite in him.
Oh, I know you do. I just love giving you a hard time because you can take it, and you'll dish it back and make a good time.
You just wait till we get to Martinsville. You ain't seen nothing yet. How's the track, bud? Let's get down to business here. How's the track?
It looks fine to me. The only thing that looks even wet is the second groove up here in the seam. Might be seeping a little bit, but other than that, it looks fine.
That's good news. Oh, by the way, you want to get those sneakers dried out, because if I get after you, you're going to be doing some running.
Oh, you're killing me. It's all good. We'll have fun. I had to put big bumpers on. I hope you got a big back bumper on yours.
That's the one you'll be looking at, my boy, the back one.
Kevin will start sixth. As you see, the four cars lined up in front of him and the pace car. Coming out of turn four, the area of concern right now is at turn three. That's where Mike Helton and John Darby were looking at the racetrack.
He was enthusiastic on that 10-4, wasn't he? 10-4.
Oh, yeah. Riding along with Michael Waltrip. Right there, that's Kenny Wallace just ahead, and Kenny Schrader is right alongside of Michael. And there are the NASCAR officials again looking over that area of the racetrack where a bit of groundwater has seeped through the racetrack. I think that's former Winston Cup crew. Is that Gary Nelson with them?
Yes. I think it was. Let's see if we can get up with the Harvick's counterpart here. Greg Biffle, this is DW. Do you read?
I got the DW.
How's the track conditions out there, bud?
Well, really, it looks okay. It's, track looks dark. Looks fairly dry. These tires don't have a lot of grip going slow like this, but it feels like it's pretty good.
All your feathers are laid down flat today, aren't they? They're not all ruffled up or anything from last week or two, are they?
No way. It's another week. It's another race. We're ready to go.
10-4, bud. Have a good day. Good luck.
It was, I believe, Roger Penske, who racing with Mark Donahue after celebrating a win, said, all right, now the clock turns back to zero. At midnight that night, the next week is a whole new week, the next race a whole new race, and everything that happened last week gets shelved away, put on that page in the history book, and we start over.
Yeah, you really don't, you can't carry the grudge, and you don't try to get even. But as I said earlier in the day, you don't make it easy for that guy. Whenever he comes around you, you make it as difficult as you can.
It's a lot easier said than done. And, looking back at Kevin Harvick there, and we was talking to him a little bit ago, this will be the sixth Busch race here at Texas. He's the only race winner in the field, considered Mark Martin won three of them, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. won the other one. They're not in the field. Kevin Harvick, the only previous winner of this race in the field today.
Is that Hook'em horns, or I mean, we are in Texas, or is that two laps and we're going racing?
I hope it's two laps and going racing.
I think it's both.
Yeah, I think you're right. Well, there's some real there's a lot of apprehension on the drivers' parts right now. Just throw out the fact that the new surface, that's enough to create havoc here. But then the weather conditions, and you got to wonder, is the track in good shape, and is it dry everywhere? And so many things are going through these guys' mind right now.
And that's where, as a crew chief, if you're on pit road, you're telling the guys, look, we've got 200 laps, we got 300 miles. Let's let everybody get settled down. Let's race the racetrack we talk about. Let's try to get to the bottom of the racetrack. Let this thing unfold and see where we end up.
Everybody says all that, Larry, and then that spotter says, green, 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 go, go, go.
And it lasts till about turn
and it all changes.
You're exactly right. Having been there and done that, you're all calm, cool, and collected. But when they come off that fourth turn and they say, go, 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 something happens.
Yeah, right. It's a light switch.
The guy that you made the deal with that you're going to let in, you forget all about it.
Oh, yeah. Goodbye. See ya. AJ Foyt looking on. Oh, the jet. Here comes the jet blower.
Oh, he's not going to be. AJ's not going to be happy about that. Huh? Well, it didn't blow his hat off, so it wasn't too bad.
Been a long time since anybody dusted off AJ Foyt.
I tell you what, if they try to, watch out for that left hook, too.
Yeah.
He's got a mean left hook.
And, I talk about A.J. and Larry Foyt. I talked to his crew chief, John Wolf, that was to the left of A.J. He said, I've been with Larry. Larry's been a year and a third on this Busch Series. He said, we absolutely had the best happy hour final practice that we've ever had. They felt real good after yesterday's practice. Came out here and tested, and felt like a lot that they learned at the test paid off with the little bit of practice they had.
Well, I tell you, a new surface on a racetrack. We got one to go here, guys. They're going to bunch them up, and let's scuff them up and get a little heat in their tires, get ready to go. But a new surface on a racetrack, track will make you feel good. It's got some grip in it, and that's what a driver likes, to feel that grip. How long will it last? That's the question.
And this old cool temperature, it's going to make that old motor feel good, too. That thing's going to be making some horsepower this cool air.
Well, it's been a long day's journey into evening. Nearly 4 hours, the rain delay here.
But we do have lights.
David Starr pulls on, does a drive-through on pit road. He's going to pick up the tail end of the field, as will the number 63 of Shane Hall. Go to the tail end. And we'll be set to go racing this time by. They both made pit stops as we come around to green this time.
One thing we got to keep an eye on, and I know NASCAR and all the corner spotters, all the corner workers are keeping an eye on, it's really getting dark over in the first and second turn. You don't want to bail off in there with a little rain falling down.
Darrell, NASCAR has determined again, due to the lack of practice, there will be a possibility of a competition yellow in the range of lap 40.
Ooh, that's a long way.
If we go green.
So. Yeah, well, I think that's a good idea. It's obviously a great idea, but.
Again, they're considering it. They've not.
Yeah.
I'd sure like to see it a little sooner if I was a crew chief on pit road.
Well, I don't want to again be the bearer of bad news, but I think you probably will.
All right. Lights are out atop the Monte Carlo pace car. Kerry Earnhardt getting set to go. These fans are set to go. 43 drivers, and you are set to go. Racing in the Busch Series at Texas. Green flag.
Green flag.
You know, it's almost like Joe Nemechek in the 87 car checked up just a little bit where he could get in behind Jeff Green in the 21 car before they got to turn one and didn't have to go in there side by side.
Yeah, I think you're right. He kind of lagged back a little bit. Of course, you know, he didn't want to have happen to him what happened to Robbie Gordon last week.
Scott Wimmer will get a black flag for passing before the start finish line. But boy,
there's a car in the wall.
One hard in the wall.
Coming down.
Everybody missed it. 34, Stuart Kirby.
My.
Making his first Busch start.
As I looked up, I think he got into the corner on the outside over there, and it's just not a good place to be.
And his Busch Series debut lasts 1 mile.
That's Jimmy Spencer's car. Jimmy's the owner of the car. As I said, Larry Carter's the crew chief. I'd like to have seen him had a better day than this.
Plan on running about 16-17 races the rest of this year. And Frank Cece, who used to be with the Cece Welliver team, Casey Mears and that group, he's actually the team manager for this race team now.
Cece was the owner when Spencer won the modified championship twice.
See, he's on the outside there. I got a good idea that he may have run in there and the cars in front of him were slowing down. He had to move out just a little bit, and when he did, he got it. You know, there's just no grip in the upper groove right now. All these cars that have been on this racetrack have all been right around the bottom or right on the white line, and so there's not much grip anywhere else.
If you get just a half a lane high, that thing will just come around you, and it happens so fast.
Well, we saw that in qualifying with Frank Kimmel. He got the right side tires going into turn one just in the gray, and around she went.
Caution at lap one for Stuart Kirby's crash. Give an attaboy to Ron Hornaday in relief of Ricky Hendrick, who's still recuperating from that separated shoulder. Hornaday started 33rd, came to 26th in three quarters of a lap.
Well, you know how he did it. I watched him. He was three wide down here in turn one up on the outside. So at that speed, I think he was okay on the start of the race. But I bet he wasn't three wide when he got to turn three.
No, sir. Matt Yoakum.
Well, Mike, when the two car of Johnny Sauter crossed the line to take the caution, he came on the radio and told his crew chief, Ricky Vyers, that the track is wet. The track is very, very wet. He said, in fact, following Jimmy Spencer is much like following a vapor trail. He said the track was that damp.
Well, we're under caution, and there is a dark cloud off of turn number two. So rain has plagued us here in Texas. We've gotten one lap in, now two, and we'll be right back with more NASCAR on Fox.
The NASCAR Busch Series on Fox, presented by Old Spice, is brought to you by 1010-220. Dial it and all calls up to 20 minutes or 99 cents. By your neighborhood 7-Eleven store. Oh, thank heaven for 7-Eleven. By the 4,000 CarQuest auto parts stores across North America. You'll find it at CarQuest. And by Old Spice, the deodorant of NASCAR.
Welcome back to Texas, where four laps are complete. Caution came out on lap one for Stuart Kirby's crash at turn three. He climbed from the car okay. He is all right. The fans have their ponchos at the ready. Dark clouds on the horizon, but right now the track's still in raceable condition. We should get back to green here shortly.
Well, I've heard several of the drivers, though, complain about moisture on the racetrack, that they feel like it might be a little damp, but I'm not out there, so I can't say, and I don't see it on anybody's windshield.
You see the windshield clear there on Michael Waltrip's car. So with four complete and the order little changed from the way they lined up to the green flag, we'll be right back to Texas after this. We're going to go green this time here in Texas. Six laps are complete. Green flag next time by. There have been a couple of NASCAR races run in the rain. The Modified Sportsman race in 1954 on Daytona's Beach Road Course, where the starting time for the race was dictated by low tide. So NASCAR had to start the race in the rain. Those cars were on groove tires, as they were in 1956 at Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin, Road America. They ran a Grand National race, groove tires on all the cars on the road course, and they did run with rain falling.
In our second year over to Suzuka, Japan, in 1997, we actually practiced and qualified in the rain. We didn't race in the rain, but we did all the practice and qualifying in the rain on groove tires.
You can do that on the road course because you don't have the side, you know, you don't get the side load here on the road course that you get on the bank track like this.
And you're not loading one corner like right. You are the right front here. You're loading, you know,
stop
left and right.
Yeah, yes. More stop and go.
Fans to their feet. Cars in single file order for this restart. Jeff Green on point, the pole sitter.
His car's off.
Here we go.
Yeah, he is. And folks, just so you know, there is a discussed restart point in the driver's meeting. It's usually right down here at the end of the beginning of pit lane. At some point, that's where the driver is supposed to take off.
Two young guns up high. Johnny Sauter in the two in the outside. Shane Meal in the 47. Going to try that doesn't yet exist second groove right away, Darrell.
I just don't think I'd want to be there going into turn three at the speed they're going in. You got to really trust the guy down underneath of you to not force you up any higher than he has to.
And you can hear Johnny Sauter in the two right there on the late exit of four, not getting the grip, had to actually back off the throttle just a little bit for a second.
Oh, he's hung out there now, and it could be like a freight train as the cars go by.
Jack Sprague underneath him. Yep, Sauter's going to pay the price here.
Well, he doesn't know it yet. He's still hanging on the outside. That's encouraging. I mean, as far as we're concerned, it shows that you can run out there. He's losing time, but he's not hitting the fence anyway.
And the fella in the truck series we called Restart Ron Hornaday picked up another three positions on that restart. Well, there's Hamilton Jr. going by and rookie Scott Riggs.
Well, what happened was that time Sauter carried it in real hard trying to get down in front of those cars. He washed up the track and really got himself in trouble.
Jeff Purvis.
Ideally, he would get down if he could, but he just can't. There's not an opening. He can't just cut down in front of somebody.
And there's still a lot of cars coming, another 10 or 12 cars lined up behind this group right here.
That's what you call, believe it or not, on a day like this, hung out to dry.
It's the only dry thing in the place, Darrell.
I can think of.
Todd Bodine underneath now, as Jeff Green is uncontested out front. Got Nemechek in second, Spencer in third, Harvick in fourth, Matt Kenseth fifth. Now, the front of the field is nicely single file.
Which is a great place to be, man. All alone out there in the front, looking in your mirror.
And back here, Randy LaJoy gets underneath.
And that's what you see in your mirror. and you keep digging so you don't have to.
Jeff Burton right behind LaJoy on the inside, and then Larry Foyt.
Boy, just driving in the corner just a teeny bit too hard, and the car goes up the hill a little bit, and man, there's somebody there to drive right under you and hang you out there to dry, as I said.
And you would think this wide of a racetrack, it wouldn't be what I call as mark sensitive, and that's hitting the right marks, timing, turning off in the corner.
Well, that's because you're entering the corner at 190 plus miles an hour. And you've just got to, Nate, you've got to hit your mark every time. Are you going to be too low? Are you going to be too high? Are you going to miss the entrance to that corner?
This race for 14th. Biffle goes by Burton, who lets him in line. There's Foyt just ahead of the 26 of Lyndon Amick.
And if you look at these cars, the pole is 193 in the Busch cars. Only 100, just a mile an hour faster for Bill Elliott. The 21 car could have started on the outside pole of the Winston Cup race. They got less power because they have a smaller carburetor, but they can run pretty almost wide open all the way around this racetrack.
When you take a little bit of power away because you're not carrying as much speed getting in the corner, it allows you to almost run through the corner, as you're saying, wide open and never have to lift.
Yep.
And the end result is almost exact lap time.
Same speed.
Jason Keller slides under Harvick. That's fourth place. Jack Sprague goes by. What's wrong with Harvick?
Boy, I don't know. He got up off the bottom there. He ought to be able to get in behind the 25 car right here.
It's Bobby Hamilton Jr. He lost another spot, too.
I think it's just the cars, you know, it gets a little bit tight on you on entry, and you move up just a little bit. And like I said, somebody's there to take your place.
And I think we're going to see that throughout the day. The more rubber that goes back down on this racetrack, the more these teams are going to have to adjust their car because they're going to get tighter and tighter. They're going to want to turn less and less with the front wheels.
That's the history of this racetrack, is tight on exit. Always seem to be able to get in the corner pretty good, but always tighten under power as you exit the turn.
Jason Keller started eighth. He has climbed to fourth. Steve?
And, Mike, let's remember, before the race even started, they discovered that they had a clutch problem. Well, he's running great on the racetrack right now. The crew chief, Steve Addington, said he's concerned when they have to bring that car onto pit road to pit. That's where they're going to have problems getting that car into gear. They'll have to push him once they're done with their pit service and hope they can catch up to the rest of the field.
Right behind Keller is Jack Sprague, Truck Series champ, and then Scott Riggs, who also came out of the Truck Series, a Busch rookie and Keller's teammate. He's come all the way up to sixth from 12th.
Now, you don't need a clutch to shift these transmissions. Once you get the thing rolling and you can get it into first gear, you really don't need a clutch. Where you're going to have a problem is when you come down pit road, you got to kick it up in neutral. When they get ready to roll off, he's going to have to be able to get it rolling, the team is, and then drop it into first gear.
And Scott Riggs in the 10 car, he got his Texas strike yesterday in happy hour. Went up there and they had to beat the side back out, but it is the same car.
Boy, Spencer really, I don't know if he just got up there and got into loose stuff and he's having trouble getting back down if there's something wrong with his car, but it looks like he's falling back in a hurry.
Yeah, well, he's got some sort of problem big time.
He went up the hill down here off of turn
four. Inside, there's two of them.
A bunch of cars went by him, almost like he thought he had a problem.
There was a spot to get in line, but he wasn't carrying enough speed. Now he does find a place in line, but he's going to drop back out of the top 15. 20 laps complete next time by Jeff Green, the leader, Joe Nemechek, Kenseth, Keller, and Sprague here at Texas.
The NASCAR Busch Series on Fox, presented by Old Spice, is brought to you by Smooth Busch Beer and Easy Drinking Busch Light. Busch, the proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series.
David Starr has made an unscheduled pit stop. Shane Hall has taken his car to the garage, and we've now completed 23 laps, with Jeff Green has led them all. Jimmy Spencer and Kevin Harvick both complaining of handling trouble.
And they're complaining about being loose. And you don't want a car pushing here, not turning. But, Darrell, if your car is loose, turning down to these corners at this speed, it just throws the whole corner off. You can't control it at all.
More than likely, if it was pushing, I could deal with it. But if you're loose at 190 miles an hour, I'm probably going to say, I'm going to be coming in pretty soon, boys.
Second place battle, Joe Nemechek, Matt Kenseth, a couple of... Well, Kenseth technically is a Bushwhacker, a Winston Cup regular who is running some Busch races. Joe Nemechek presently without a Winston Cup ride, driving the Busch car that he owns in second place.
Brian Patty, his crew chief, told me this morning, since Joe is eligible for the Winston All-Star race in Charlotte after winning Rockingham last year, they may actually fill the car out of their Busch shop for him in the Winston if everything can be pulled together financially.
They're about 2.5 seconds behind Jeff Green.
This is the same car. This is one of the oldest cars Joe Nemechek in that group has. He won Atlanta last spring with this car. This is a car he really likes at these type of racetracks. But right now, he had his hands full. Matt Kenseth goes by him for second place.
Now, he let Kenseth go by. Dick Berggren, what's up?
Well, on lap 17, Nemechek keyed the radio and said he was tight in turn three.
Now, right behind them at fourth place, now about 1.6 seconds behind them, Jack Sprague has just passed Jason Keller, and Sprague is running down that second and third place battle.
And that's no big surprise. Jack Sprague has run trucks here, run really well here in the truck series. He's got some experience. That's a Hendrick Motorsports operation. No big surprise that he's running that well.
He actually won the truck race here a year ago in June. Look at there. He's about over 2 miles an hour faster than our leader right now, Jeff Green.
But look at that speed. That's 10 mile an hour almost, 9 mile an hour slower than they qualified. And that's what we tried to tell the folks, you know, about the track and the race conditions and qualifying conditions. We don't see those incredible speeds that we see in qualifying, even on this new racetrack.
Riding with Johnny Sauter, looking back at Greg Biffle, 11th and 12th place.
Well, Biffle looks like he drives it in a little deeper than Johnny Sauter, but he pays the price on the exit of the corner. Just can't quite get back to the throttle as quick as Johnny Sauter in the two.
And we saw him do that at Darlington. Remember, he was trying to chase down Jeff Burton at the end of the race in Ireland last couple laps. I mean, he would run into the back of Burton in the getting into the corner, but Burton beat him off a little bit.
Now they've caught Randy LaJoy in the number seven, who is 10th.
Well, I mean, the guys are racing hard right now. There's some passing going on, but they're doing it rather cautiously, believe it or not, if you can be cautious at 188 mile an hour.
Derek Cope in the 94, going a lap down to race leader Jeff Green, who's now opened a 2.7 second advantage on Matt Kenseth.
Need to note that Shane Hall in the 63 car took his car to the garage a few laps ago to call his day quits.
Joining Stuart Kirby, who crashed at lap one. So Jeff Green, the 2000 series champion, now Winston Cup regular for the second time in his career, has the lead at 31 laps in Texas. Jimmy Spencer was fighting hard to keep from going a lap down, but Jeff Green muscles his way inside. Going to take Matt Kenseth with him. Boy, if you lose the handle here, you can lose a lap in a hurry.
Yeah, not only that, but you can lose a big lead trying to get by somebody that's going a lap down like Jimmy Spencer, who has a good car. He's just handling it off a little bit right now.
Once Jeff Green caught Jimmy Spencer, it knocked over a half a second a lap out of his lap times for over five or six laps.
And look, it allowed Kenseth to close right up on the back of Green.
Now, Kevin Harvick is now only three or four seconds away from going a lap down. Let's get an update there from Matt.
Mike, out here in the 29, said the crew is concerned about his Chevrolet. Kevin came on the radio and said the car is loose. His crew chief, Bobby Leslie, told him, just hang on. There will probably be a mandatory caution by NASCAR on or around lap 40. And we'll try to make adjustments then, but he is losing a lot of track time. He had climbed a few positions from his sixth starting spot, but he's faded all the way back to 28.
And that's why Spencer was fighting so hard to keep from going a lap down, trying to make it to lap 40. When we expect NASCAR to throw this caution flag that was anticipated for teams to be allowed to come to pit road and check their tires if they wish to. They don't have to, but they will be allowed to if that caution flag flies. Fourth and fifth place, Joe Nemechek, Scott Riggs, the veteran, the rookie.
Scott Riggs is having a real good run, and of course his teammate is too. Those cars are, they're so well prepared. They got great people. They run well every week. They're championship contenders. I think if I was Scott Riggs, I'd be pretty happy to be a part of that little program right there.
Of course, the 10 car, along with his teammate Jason Keller, uses Robert Yates engines. And this 10 car is also the car that Jeff Green won Kansas with last year. Good car, good motor package.
Well, the leaders, now, he just got to keep on running up on good. That's Mike McLaughlin there. And he's going to keep on running up on good cars, which is going to make it difficult. As you see, Kenseth taking a look to the inside there. I think Kenseth might be a little quicker than the 21.
Well, I think the 21's quick, Darrell, and it gets in behind cars. And I won't even say the word. I'm going to describe it another way. His car won't turn behind other cars.
I'm going to hang myself if you say that
because it loses the front downforce. It will not turn behind other cars. He's good and clean air, but yeah, we have caution to say it.
Mandatory caution, I believe. That's the 40-lap mark. Now the question is...
Well, what a break for Mike McLaughlin in the 18, Kevin Harvick in the 29. Those guys right on the verge of going a lap down here. Is it this competition caution, if you might call it, whatever comes out on lap 41, this will give the teams a chance to adjust their race cars and look at those tires.
And I like this because 40 laps, that's pretty hard 40 laps. Had a little caution there early on, but those have been about 30 or so laps of hard running. It's a good time to look at the tires.
And this is a fairly common occurrence when NASCAR comes to a new or newly paved racetrack and there's a concern about tire wear. The number one priority here is safety. So they run a length of green flag racing and throw a caution so everyone can check and make sure that they haven't gone so far out of the ballpark on setup that they're going to have excess tire wear and cause a failure and a real problem.
And it's not mandatory. It's just a safety check. Teams right now, they could change two tires. They can do anything they want. It's to their discretion, but they're throwing it for the ability for these teams to do this.
Kind of like just like calling a timeout in basketball or football. An official's timeout, let's call it.
But I think we will see everyone to pit road here 40 laps into a run. This is about two-thirds of the way through a run.
Now, since the caution is out, if you change tires, are you charged with using a set?
Absolutely.
Sure, okay. You are, yeah.
Dick Bergman.
Joe Nemechek said the car feels as if it's tipping over on the right front, so they're going to add air pressure on the two right side tires that they're putting on the car, hopefully to correct that problem. Nemechek has got nothing in front of him. He's got a great spot to pit here. Open pit in front of him. To Steve.
Hey, Dick, Jeff Green's on pit road. They took 1 pound out of the left front. They added a pound into the right rear. Talked about a wedge adjustment, but they are not going to do that. Let's check in with Matt.
Kevin Harvick already being serviced. Ronnie Auto going to work on the right rear. He pulled a spring rubber out. They were talking about him putting a spring rubber in the left rear because Kevin said he just cannot keep his car in the gas. The car is loose. As Ronnie hits the lugs on that left rear, and Harvick is down and away.
So caution out for the second time today. This is a competition yellow at lap 40. So we've completed 42 laps. And we'll be back with NASCAR Busch Series Racing presented by Old Spice on Fox.
Yeah, welcome back live to Texas. NASCAR Racing across the Fox networks continuing tomorrow. Start your race day with NASCAR this morning presented by Smirnoff Ice. That's on Fox Sports Net, followed by the Samsung Radio Shack 500 on Fox at our pre-race show from the Hollywood Hotel. And then wrap it all up on NASCAR Victory Lane. That's on Fox Sports Net. The Fox networks, your home for NASCAR. Jack Sprague, your leader. Stuart Kirby, the only driver out of the race. Let's go trackside. Check in with Steve Byrne. Steve?
Well, Chris, as we said at the beginning of the race, the pit crew for the 21 team had practiced twice a day for the past 2 weeks at Bristol. Jeff Green won the race in that car, but his pit crew was the crew off the number 31 Winston Cup team, teammates at Richard Childress Racing. They lost time. They had problems on the front tire. But the good news is, the tire wear looks great. Let's go to Dick Bergeron.
I'm in Matt Kenseth's pit. Just looked over the tires here, and they look terrific as well. Don't see any possibility of tire problems so far. Kenseth started in fifth spot, worked his way to second, came out of the pits in second. The only adjustment, air pressure. Matty.
Dick, down here in the 10 pit is Scott Riggs. The tires that came off the rookie's number 10 car looked good. As we're getting ready for green, he said his car was going to the tight side. They made a wedge adjustment.
Jack Sprague out in front in the NASCAR Busch Series. First race he's led since New Hampshire in August 1993. He spent a lot of time since then in the truck series.
His group, Dennis Conley's crew, did a great job on pit road. Goes from third to first, takes the lead here. Restart lap 45.
I think once he gets out front, he's going to be pretty hard. I think he'll be somebody that's going to be tough to deal with.
Jimmy Spencer was the first car lined up on the inside. Couldn't get a lap back.
Oh, trouble down here. Who is that? Is that the 26
or it is? Amick.
Oh, no. A car just turned down. One car just turned over. It's upside down on the back straightaway.
It's Michael.
Holy cow, what is he doing?
He slammed into Amick, Darrell, and that flip turned the car right over. Look at how he hit him with the right front.
Well, he needs to get out of there. Come on, buddy. Get that fire extinguisher up here.
You okay, Michael?
Lyndon Amick spun between turns one and two, and sliding down the racetrack was collected by Michael Waltrip.
Well, he's such a, you know, Michael is 6'5", he weighs about 230. It's hard for him to, he can't just jump out of the race car. But I think I see him down there. I think I see him in there moving around.
Yeah, he was moving around. The picture froze because of damage done to the in-car camera mechanism by the flip. The antenna is buried against the asphalt. So all we saw was a couple of stills, but it did indicate that he is moving in the car.
You saw real quickly on the side of his seat, LaJoy's seat. That's a seat that is designed by Randy LaJoy. We talk a lot about Jeff Burton playing a role in safety for drivers. Randy LaJoy been doing this with the seats for a long time.
Now, I've been in there like that, and you want to cut the seatbelt loose, or you want to undo the seatbelt, but if you do, you fall down on your head. So you got to be, you can see he's trying to move around in there and get himself in a position to get out. But with all those headrests and the Hans device and everything else, upside down is not a good place to be.
Michael Waltrip had a wreck at Bristol, Tennessee, where there was not
very
left of the car. He's fine.
He's just,
wow. Thank goodness.
But he's okay.
Yeah, I see him now.
Could be that some of that fire extinguisher powder, you know, he looks like he's
looking just, to see what. No, just, how's my car? Yeah. He's fine, Darrell. When you start looking, how's my car?
Yeah.
He's okay.
Yeah, that's kind of the first.
Now,
even when you're hurt, you always want to know how the car is.
Remember, he's the driver and owner of that car.
Let's see if we can see. Well, I know what started all this. 26 car back here. He gets around on his own. People start taking evasive action. He's coming down the hill. All of a sudden,
here comes Michael right there. Just
there it goes.
Over the left front, catapults him upside down.
Just turned him right over. Several cars involved. See the 26 car get around right there.
And everybody's trying to crowd down to the bottom,
knowing he's going to go to the bottom of the racetrack.
The 54 car.
Yeah, Kevin Grubb.
Kevin
is involved.
Grubb.
So is Casey Kane.
Yates's car, Casey Kane, 98.
Now from Johnny Sauter's car.
Oh yeah, the 26 just gets around backwards.
Let's ride with Lyndon Amick.
Boy, that thing had been no warning.
See Michael go by right there.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Lyndon Amick taking a couple of hard shots.
Yeah, that old Dr. Pepper car was getting hit from all angles.
Yeah, 10, 2, and 4.
It was so crowded there, right where Michael was. There was cars inside, outside. Tried to cut down under Amick and got up on his left front, went up over his left front wheel and just flipped him upside down.
Michael was headed down lower and the 54 car shot him back up the racetrack. That's when he drove across the left front of Lyndon Amick's car.
2 years ago, he took a bad tumble at Daytona and flipped from the trioval all the way down to turn one. Now, Matt Kenseth is one of the cars that has made a pit stop under this caution. Dick?
Well, he actually made two pit stops under this caution, one of which was before this. Now, the second caution came out for Michael Waltrip's crash. He came back in again. Problem was he felt the vibration. The vibration was the left front wheel was not properly on the car, so he had to come back in again. They fixed it. They were worried about the brakes. When he left, he said he thinks that the brakes are okay.
Thanks, Dick. Jack Spray continues to lead Joe Nemechek and Scott Riggs from Kevin Harvick.
Wow.
More NASCAR Busch Series on Fox after this.
The NASCAR Busch Series on Fox, presented by Old Spice, is brought to you by Papa John's. Better ingredients, better pizza. By Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. Be you, nothing's better, Dr. Pepper. By John Deere, nothing runs like a deer. And by Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
Welcome back to Texas, where we're quarter distance, halfway to halfway. We're not racing the rain so much anymore. That big storm cloud at turn two has drifted off toward Dallas. Jack Sprague's our leader, Joe Nemechek, Scott Riggs. A little bit of blue sky up above turn four as we complete 50 laps with Michael Waltrip's car turned turtle after the crash with Lyndon Amick. So we're under yellow at 50 laps. Our subway race summary, two different leaders of this race, Jeff Green and Jack Sprague, just one lead change. Average speed under Green, they've been running 181 miles an hour. 31 cars are on the lead lap. We're working the third caution flag, 14 laps of yellow. Lyndon Amick's car will go to the garage and join Michael Waltrip and Stuart Kirby. Shane Hall was in the garage, but he's returned to the racetrack. Dick Bergeron.
Well, here's the story on Matt Kenseth's car. This lug nut got trapped between the wheel and the brake caliper. All this junk in the inside, that's not the stud. All the studs are on the left front, but this caused a vibration. They thought they had a loose wheel. They came in, they took it off. They took a real careful look at it. Kenseth, everything is okay, but he's in the back of the pack. He had been running second.
Matt Kenseth will restart 29th, and Spider-Man, a rough day for the Webbed One.
That's a great ride if you go to Universal Studios.
Welcome back to Texas, the NASCAR Busch Series presented by Old Spice. Today's race, the O'Reilly Auto Parts 300. You saw Michael Waltrip's car that they flipped over and put on the rollback. Let's see Michael Waltrip. Matt?
Well, Mike, he has walked out of the infield care center. First off, you okay, Michael?
Yeah, I'm fine. I don't really know what happened other than I slowed down and someone ran over me and I flipped. So I'm not real sure what led up to all that. But, you know, NASCAR does a great job with the safety personnel. So when they got there and it was on fire, they put it out. But we still have to do something about how little these cars were. I was trapped. I mean, I couldn't get out of it. And, you know, there's still room inside of the cars to make them bigger without doing anything. Just mandate how big the roll cages have to be. And my car was probably a little bit smaller than it should have been, and I couldn't get out of it. And that's a concern of mine. But thankfully, they were right there to attend to me, and I got out.
How scary was that? Because this is the second time in over a year you've had to crawl out the side window at Michigan in your cup car, and now this.
It wasn't scary. I don't care, you know. The only thing you're scared of is when you can't see where you're going, that you're going to hit something. And so you're hanging on thinking, please don't hit anything, please don't hit anything. When it stops and you hit anything, then you just think about getting out. And when I couldn't get out, that sucked. But the Aaron's Dream Machine will race another day, and so will Michael. Tomorrow, I hope, for all our fans on Fox, check us out. It'll be a great race tomorrow. I think the track is widening out. I'd already gotten up on the outside a little bit and saw some success with it early in this race. So I think that you'll see a great race tomorrow. Hats off to Texas Motor Speedway. They paved this place and did a fine job. And thank God for these fans, man. They are so fanatical about our sport. It's a lot of fun to be down here in Texas. Once a year, anyway. Who wouldn't like to come twice, as cool as it is down here?
Glad to see you're okay, Mike. Let's go to Jeff Hammond. Jeff?
Guys, you're wondering about how well Michael was able to crawl out of that car and why the roof didn't collapse. Let me show you right quick. Look down inside here on our cutaway car. You see this big halo bar that goes around? They also have a bar that runs right beside the driver's head here to help support the roof in case it gets on his lid. Also, they've got a bar that runs from the center of the car all the way up through to this right front corner to help support this halo bar also. All these things are done with the idea, in case you do get upside down, the car will not collapse, the roof will not collapse on the driver, give an opportunity to get out. But as you can see, this is a pretty confined area. As big as Michael is, trying to get by his headrest, down by probably his air condition, and out the side window for a guy that's, what, 6'5", 240 pounds, it's not an easy task. But again, you see Michael Walter get out of his car without any kind of injury because of the way these cars are built. Darrell?
Yeah, Jeff, I was just going to say that if you you look at the angle of the windshield bar, too, how much that's one of the reasons why we had to add those little bars there on top of the door bars. There's the windshields laid back so far in these cars now that they had to add a lot of bars in there to keep the roof from coming down or the bars from caving in on the drivers when they got upside down.
And all those roll bars are what we call 095, almost an eighth of an inch thick wall, seamless tubing. So, I mean, it's about the best tubing you can buy, inch and three-quarter in diameter.
Give an attaboy to Mr. Let's Make a Deal. Kenny Wallace drove right through the middle of all that, and I think he got through unscathed.
Yes, he did.
Now, this is from Kevin Harvick.
Harvick did a pretty darn good job, too, because he's going down there, headed right into the middle of disaster.
Whoa.
Gets back up on the track, minute. And here comes Michael, and he's just lucky he didn't get run over. Harvick's lucky he didn't get run over from, like, that 18 car, for instance.
All right, the car that triggered all this was Lyndon Amick, and that's with him.
Well, Mike, he, too, has walked out of the infield care center. You look all right, Lyndon. You all right?
Yeah, I'm fine. It's just, man, I don't know what happened. I got down in the middle of the corner, and it's just like, snap, turned around. You know, I didn't feel like I was out of the groove or anything. I don't know if I got hit or not. I'm driving the car, so whatever happened is at the end is my fault, I guess. But, you know, Dr. Pepper, this is their home track, and we're trying to promote the movie Spider-Man. And
that was a great paint scheme.
It was. It's an awesome paint scheme. It's tore up now. He was in there. He was trying to help me, but he couldn't get over there quick enough. But, you know, we just hate it. The Dr. Pepper are great people, and just trying to do the best we can here. Hopefully this monkey will get off our back, and we can do something next week.
What Lyndon was talking about, they had a Spider-Man action figure bungee corded to the roll bar. He's done for the day.
Yeah, Lyndon's spidey sense didn't help him that time. Tough break for him. A couple of raindrops coming down again. 55 laps complete. If we make 100, that's halfway. The race would be official. The race distance today, 200 laps, 300 miles. Jack Sprague is our leader. Joe Nemechek, Scott Riggs, Jeff Green, and Jeff Purvis are your top five under caution.
The NASCAR Busch Series on Fox, presented by Old Spice, is brought to you by Old Spice, the deodorant of NASCAR.
Welcome back to Texas, where 57 laps are complete. Jack Sprague is our race leader. You see the interval wipers going there on the pace car. And in that accident, you saw Kenny Wallace just sneak right through there. Here's what happened.
Kept grabbing gears and found him a hole just to slide through. Never panicked.
All right, Darrell, let's catch up with there's Wallace unscathed after sliding through that wreck scene. Let's catch up with our second place driver.
Yeah, we'll talk to Kenny maybe here in a minute, but right now we're going to talk to Joe Nemechek. Joe, how you read DW up here?
10-4.
How's the track, bud? Is it starting to rain again?
Yeah, it's almost. It's just barely raining right now, but a couple laps ago it let loose pretty good down in turns 1 and 2. Track's actually looks like it's turning a little bit black down there.
Before this caution, bud, how was your car?
I've been a little bit loose in, a little bit tight off. Manage that first run, let the guys look at the tires real good. Everything's okay, so I think I'll be ready to go here.
All right, well, let's hope it quits raining, and we wish you well up there, bud. Good luck.
10-4.
Joe Nemechek's the second-place car. Let's go to the pits of the leader, who is Jack Sprague. Here's Steve.
Mike, with Dennis Conner. Dennis, boy, your pit crew gave you a great stop, gave you the lead. What's Jack saying about the race car?
Actually, once he got in clean air, the race car's perfect. It was a little bit loose in when he was in traffic, but it's been fast the entire race, and the Net Zero crews worked real hard with all the resources available to us at Hendricks to figure out the aero package required for these Busch cars. And we're not quite there yet, but we're getting closer. It's a good day for us if we can just maintain and finish the race.
All right, when we come back, we'll talk to Kenny Wallace. We saw him sneak through that accident scene. He was both lucky and good to get through as Lyndon Amick crashed and Michael Waltrip got turned over. There's a look at Kenny. We'll be right back. You're watching NASCAR on Fox, presented by Old Spice.
Welcome back. Fox welcomes you back to Texas Motor Speedway. It's Sunday, April 14th, the world's best kart drivers race for glory in the 20th running of the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. Paul Tracy, Jimmy Vassar, Michael Andretti try to end Cristiano D'Amato's three-race win streak. It's the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach, Sunday, April 14th, 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific, right here on Fox. Under our third caution after a lengthy rain delay of 3 hours and 40 minutes, Chris Myers with Jeff Hammond here in the Hollywood Hotel. Jack Sprague actually leading this race. His only other finish here at the Texas Busch Series was 43. That was a couple of years ago. He actually left during a rain delay that was lengthy, and they finished up without him. So anything could happen here. I want to go back, and you showed us in the cutaway car. Thank goodness Michael Waltrip is okay. But he pointed out that the room around where the driver is, obviously a lot of safety requirements there, but maybe a little more space might be something that could benefit drivers of his size or all drivers in that situation.
Yes, Chris, as a matter of fact, you know, back in the late 70s and early 80s, they downsized the car. And what happened right there, a lot of time, the bigger cars at that time, the drivers had more room inside the car, more door bars as far as the space between you and the side door bar, as well as headroom. Smaller cars, I think everybody who's ever understood the fact that they did downsize cars, that has affected racers. They do not have as much room inside the cockpit area we keep talking about. No, so if we can make the cars bigger and give them some more crushable area, it'd be better.
Yeah, so not only to move around, but space, crushable, whatever you want to call it. It gives a cushion there, sort of.
It all has to do with dissipating energy when you get into a wreck or whatever. You know, bigger is better in that aspect right there. If you had something where it could absorb more energy, should dissipate more energy, should make it better for the drivers.
All right, thankfully okay after his car was flipped over. Let's go back upstairs. Darrell Waltrip, Larry McReynolds, and Mike Joy.
Thanks, Chris. We're going to take you through Mr. Toad's wild ride. We have Kenny Wallace's onboard camera. We've cleaned up the tape a little bit, had to sanitize a little audio here as he runs through a very tense situation down in turn one.
Up real high. Stay low. They're packing up. Watch.
Made it.
Kenny likes to do play by play.
Come back. You all right?
I think I got flat spotted tires though.
Flat spotted them.
I don't know. Hold on. Yes, I think I got flat spotted tires.
Hell of a job missing that wreck.
Shit, like you ain't believe it, dude. I had to drive my way through it.
And what he means by
I thought we cleaned it up.
What he means by flat spotted tires, he got on the brakes so hard it actually slid the tires and it will flat spot them. And the reason he told him to wait, let me find out, he tried to go through three and four hard, and if they're flat spotted, it'll vibrate.
Right. Kenny, if you come to the racetrack, folks, you need to rent a scanner from one of the vendors at the track, and you can listen into the team conversations, listen into your favorite driver as the race goes along. And Kenny's entertaining to listen to. He's done some radio and TV work. He likes to do play-by-play from the seat of the race car as he's racing. He is a hoot to listen to.
You can tell when we interview him that, you know, without the adrenaline of the race car flowing, he's already hyped up. So you put him in a situation like it right there, and he gets very animated.
All right, now Jason Keller had some problems at the top of the day, one of the contenders for the Busch Series Championship. Let's get an update from Steve.
Yeah, Mike, the clutch went bad. Steve, adding to the crew chief, how is that clutch affecting the race car?
It's not affecting us on the racetrack. It's restarts. He's just being real careful. But our pit stops is where it's hurting us, getting out of the pits. We're having to push him off and let him jam it in gear.
And Darrell, it's exactly the way you described it. They only lost two spots on that last stop.
Track drying efforts are just about complete here. The jet drying trucks are pulling off the track.
We got to get that vortex going, Mike. We got to get the vortex going again to keep the clouds away.
That's right, Darrell. We're going to get one to go this time. Jack Sprague is the race leader. Now, he used to race full-time in the Busch Series, driving for Bill Bumgarner, the base motorsports team. Lost the ride when Johnny Benson moved from the ASA, left that series as champion to come into Busch. And for Bumgarner, Benson won Rookie of the Year and then the Busch Championship. So Sprague went to the Truck Series. His best career finish, second at Pulaski Speedway in Virginia in 1992.
And this is a great opportunity for Jack, driving one of the Hendrick Motorsports entries. He and Ricky Hendrick, and Ron Hornaday's driving Ricky's car because Ricky's got a broken shoulder. Dennis Conner and Jack have had great success in the Truck Series, winning the championship three times. So this team could be a contender, a sleeper all year long.
You saw Matt Kenseth come out of the pits. He was at the tail end of the lead lap anyway, so he stopped to top off.
Nothing to lose. You know, at your back of the pack, we ran about 12 or 13 caution laps, so go on and top that tank off. You don't really give up anything.
All right, cars in the outside lane are on the lead lap, and the start has been waved off. The restart's been waved off for at least a lap. We'll check on that when we come back. You're watching the NASCAR Busch Series on Fox, presented by Old Spice.
The NASCAR Busch Series on Fox, presented by Old Spice, is brought to you by Dr. Scholl's. Look, feel, do better. By AC Delco Automotive Parts, when the right way is the only way. By Applebee's Neighborhood Grill and Bar, eating good in the neighborhood, Applebee's. And by Smooth Busch Beer and easy drinking Busch Light. Busch, the proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series.
Welcome back to Texas. 65 laps complete. The restart was waved off because of a bit of seepage up in turn three. The track was still wet in that area. They've gone and done a little track drying and run the cars through that a couple more times, and now we're on one to go. Sprague the leader, Nemechek, Riggs, Jeff Green the pole sitter, Jeff Purvis up in the top five. Then Bobby Hamilton Jr. running sixth, and then this man, Jason Keller.
I want to talk one more time about his situation. We talked to his crew chief, Steve Addington, and again, the only problem he has when he has to use the clutch is when he leaves the pits. Well, you would think if he has to restart in second gear, he has to use the clutch to go to third and fourth gear. But, Darrell, these transmissions have what we call straight-cut gears. No synchronizer rings. You just shift them without a clutch, banging them through with RPMs.
Yeah, exactly. It's the Jericho transmission. More than likely, it could be a Tex transmission as well. But no synchronizer rings.
The only time that clutch plays a role is when you have to leave pit road when you're at a standstill.
And if they can get him rolling a little bit, he can kind of get the thing jammed in gear and go.
Don't try this at home, folks, or you'll be rebuilding your transmission every 300 miles, just like these teams do.
Yeah. These are racing transmissions.
Set for the restart.
That's what that whine is you hear, by the way. That's those straight cut gears in there just kind of meshing together.
Well, let's hear some more of it. Those of you with surround sound at home, let's crank it up for the restart at lap 66. Spencer leads the field around to the flag, but it's the black flag for Spencer.
Yeah.
Because he beat the race leader, Jack Sprague, on the restart, and he will get a stop and go.
Well, as you mentioned it earlier, Mike, there's a restart area back about the entrance of pit road where the leader starts him, but he has to cross the start-finish line first. You can't beat him across that start-finish line.
So Spencer will take the penalty stop.
Yeah, Spencer just now coming down in front of the whole field to go on pit road.
He has to be so careful here, 45 miles an hour. You don't want another penalty for speeding on pit road.
That's usually what happens because you're angry, you don't like what happened, don't think it's necessary. Kind of lose your whole day.
Stop and go.
Goes up in smoke.
You heard him say stop and go. He'll have to stop at his sign. He'll leave the pits immediately, but the leader's already Jack Sprague in turn four. He's going to be borderline.
Spencer got a great restart. It was just a little too green.
Yeah, it was. And that 10 and that 21 are having, I tell you, they are having at it.
Oh, Riggs.
They came off turn four there while going three wide. They went around a lap car, one on the inside, one on the outside. I believe Scott Riggs has got his hot rod tuned up now, Larry. He is moving.
Up to third place. Now, Spencer beat Sprague to the line on the restart. Could Sprague have pedaled it and eased off so that Spencer would beat him to the line?
Well, you know, that's a good question, Mike, and only Sprague will know.
Agree.
But you're exactly right. That's sometimes you do that when you got somebody like Jimmy Spencer who's very aggressive. You know he's going to be ready for that restart. You might goose it, back off, and let him go.
Here's a good battle for 13th. Right, Jeff Burton in the 9 car, the green car, looking out of Johnny Sauter's car. And, Darrell, what I like, I believe we're getting a little bit of a second groove already. These guys are able to run side by side.
Yeah, they've been working on it. It's still treacherous out there. Got to be careful. I've seen several cars, particularly in turn one, go in on the outside, but they slide up the hill a pretty good bit. That's what happened to the 9 car just a little bit ago.
Boy, and Greg Biffle almost lost to Larry Foyt goes by because Biffle lost all that momentum when the car got sideways on him.
Seemed like they're having more trouble in turn one.
Yeah, it's pushed a really, really, really bad.
10-4, just hang on to it here. It ain't long to halfway. You may get some more weather. Nice and smooth.
Now that gleam off the car is not sunlight. The lights have come on here in Texas. Here's another look. Watch the 60 of Biffle.
Oh, that's just a kiss.
Just run out of real estate.
Just a kiss. I don't think he even pancaked it, Mike.
No, not even, Darrell.
No.
Just kissed it.
Well, Spencer has been in this position twice today already.
Trying to hold off the leader to keep from going a lap down.
Well, he actually tried to go two down now.
Right? Actually, yeah, he's a lap down right now, almost two laps down because he was right at the tail end of the lead lap earlier.
I believe his car, you know, he was real loose to start the race. That's how he lost the lap. I think he's got his car a lot better, but that penalty is going to really be hard to overcome.
You heard Dennis Conner, though, Jack Sprague's crew chief, talk about how good his car was in clean air. He's not in clean air behind Jimmy Spencer. Meanwhile, Joe Nemechek in 87, Scott Riggs in a 10, they're right up on the rear bumper of Jack Sprague.
That 10 car is awesome. I mean, he has closed down on these guys, and he is running some good lap times. He's about 2/10 quicker a lap than the 24 or the 87. Now, we talked and heard about all for 2 days now about how hard it is to pass. That's going to be the hard thing for Riggs is can he get by these guys even though he's faster.
Right now, Riggs, he is about 2/10 of a lap faster. At least he was trying to catch these guys. Boy, Joe Nemechek's car really looks good through the middle of the corner, right along that white line. Looks like he's picking that throttle up real early.
Yeah, he said his car was a little free in the get-go there, and that's a sign of a free car. When you can get back in the throttle in the middle like that, question is, can you hang on to it?
Let's mention that one of Tim Sauter's crewmen, Sean Pincola, the right side tire changer, was struck by a loose tire on pit road. He's been taken to the care center, and they've decided to transport him to Parkland Hospital in Dallas for observation. He is conscious, talking to everybody, but as a precaution, they want to take him and check him out.
And these tires and wheels mounted with the safety inner liner, they weigh about 65 or 70 pounds, so that's quite a bundle when it goes and hits your body.
And I know the racing on the track is what we all come to see, and that's where the racing should be. But I tell you, these pit crews are so competitive now. Everybody trying to do 14, 15-second pit stops. That it's a madhouse down there.
A couple of Tennessee boys, Bobby Hamilton Jr. pulling up on Jeff Purvis. This is the battle for fifth place. Right behind them, Keller and LaJoy.
Good job for both those guys. The 37 car, Purvis, and you heard Bobby Hamilton Sr. talk about Fred Wonky, who's the crew chief on Bobby Hamilton Jr.'s car. He was a Ted Musgrave's crew chief in the Truck Series last year when Ted won 7 races.
We talked to Bobby Hamilton Jr. earlier today, and he was so pleased with the way his car is driving. He turns right to the bottom right here. He said, my car drives the same in traffic as it does out there by itself.
Well, Fred's very knowledgeable. He worked for me when Bickle drove our truck, and we almost won the championship in 97. And Fred's a smart guy, and he knows how to get a car around a racetrack.
He's also a big practical joker.
Oh, I love him.
Yeah.
Fun to hang out with.
All right, Dave.
Excuse me. He and Dave McCarty, they worked on that car together, and they were a real pair. Or on that truck, actually.
Jeff Purvis got up the groove and has dropped to the back end of that groove.
you ever get out of the groove and you have to lift that throttle just a little bit as fast as these cars are going around here, you lose a lot of spot, a lot of real estate in a hurry.
Well, and again, we talked about the 390 carburetor, and you will lose, with that carburetor, you need to run it wide open if you can, because you're going to lose a lot of steam when you lift up out of the throttle.
And that's a 390 CFM versus like an 830 that the Winston Cup cars run, and that's about 80 to 100 horsepower off the Winston Cup cars.
And that number is how many cubic feet per minute of air will flow through that carburetor. Bigger is better.
Bigger is better.
Shane Meal running a 10th place with Jeff Burton.
Now, Burton was up. Burton lost a lot of spots there just a few minutes ago. He went real high down in turns one and two, and he fell way back, and now he's having to work his way back around some of these cars.
But Shane Meal, he showed so much experience right there. He moved over before they got to turn three. He saw Jeff Burton caught him that quick. Move over. Let him in there before you get to turn three. Don't race side by side. Todd Bodine in the 92 has come to pit road. This would be an unscheduled stop.
Yeah, and he just shot off turn four onto pit road. Something suddenly happened to Bodine.
Here we are right here. Four tires, nice and smooth. Let's go, guys, let's go.
You just always have so much concern about the tires. Matt, what's he saying?
Bloody W, he came on the radio on lap 79 and told his crew chief, Tony Liberati, that he had a vibration inside the pit. There is a little bit of damage, it looks like, and you'll have a better view of it from that right front. It looks like one of the crew members holds up a lug nut. Tony is not a happy camper.
16.3 second stop. And Casey Mears comes onto pit road. These are not scheduled stops. Johnny Sauter there battling with Shane Meal, 47. And the fastest car on the racetrack right now, number 17, Matt Kenseth.
Yes, he is. He's moved up to 13th. They just moved up to 12th by Shane Meal. And that's in about 20 laps when he restarted after that last caution, back at about 28th or 29th. So he's definitely the fastest car on the racetrack after recovering from that pit stop where he had to come back to pit road.
Yeah, and he just flew by. I mean, he put a Linda Ronstadt on that two car.
Blew by you.
Blew by you.
You taught me that last year.
That's right.
I'm
sing it,
attention.
DW. Well, early today, the song we were all singing was It's Raining Again. But right now, clean and green in Texas, 15 laps to halfway when this race would be official, 115 laps to go the scheduled distance. And Jack Sprague, seeking his first Busch Series win, is out front as Todd Bodine returns to pit road. Welcome back to the NASCAR Busch Series presented by Old Spice. Mike Joy with Darrell Waltrip and Larry McReynolds. Todd Bodine returned to the pits to replace that lug nut. Ken Schrader has now come to pit road, and the hood is up on his car as Jack Sprague leads. Joe Nemechek, rookie Scott Riggs, pole sitter Jeff Green, and Bobby Hamilton Jr. are the front five. 19 cars on the lead lap as we close in on halfway, 8 laps from now.
And the 24 hours of Texas is going on pretty good right now.
We've had breakfast up here, we've had lunch, and they're bringing us dinner.
Bringing us dinner. This is really fun.
Folks, I think we figured out what happened here. It took a little noodling out. But remember 2 weeks ago at Bristol, Tennessee, on the last lap, Jack Sprague, 24, was a lapped car. Jimmy Spencer was trying to go for the win. The caution's out in turn two. Here they come to the checker, and Spencer turns Sprague around hard into the fence. Well, folks, paybacks are what? Here we come for the restart. Now, Sprague's got to get to the line first. Spencer gets a good run. Here they come. Sprague lets him go, and Spencer's illegally is going to get a black flag. Do you think it happened on purpose or not?
I do now.
And you know what I like about that payback? There's no fine, there's no probation, and nobody has a tore-up race car.
And Jimmy Spencer won't forget that, I know, because he knows that he was set up. That's an old short track trick. That's something A.J. Foyt would do right there back about 20 years ago.
How about that?
Rain here in the pits.
Well, let's go to pit road and the leader's pit. Here's Steve.
Mike, Jack Sprague likes that car right now, but he said the car is just a little bit tight from the center off. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment when they stop next time. And let's go to Dick Bergeron.
Now, Casey Mears is behind pit wall right now. Clyde McLeod has got his head underneath the engine compartment. A lot of water poured out when he first came behind the wall. They're not sure what has caused it, but he's got a serious overheating problem. Plug wires off on the left side.
Thanks, Dick. Five laps to halfway. We are again racing the rain showers and trying to get this race to official distance as Ken Schrader's car is pushed to the garage. Now, it's sprinkling, so Nemechek is going to go after Jack Sprague, and right now.
You got it. He's after him, and so is Riggs. Everybody's turned up the heat.
But you know what these guys are going to be faced with, Jeff Hammond? We're five laps from halfway. The skies are getting darker, but I'm about 15 laps away from having to come to pit road. But what we have to remember, Jeff, we saw a lot of cars come to pit road before we went back racing at the back of the pack that topped off. They can go a little further.
Is it, if you come too soon, the weather might get you. But the thing is, I'm looking at, if you hit it just right, I think, you know you've got to kind of gamble. It's going to go green for the duration. We got lights here at Texas. We can run the entire race. So you got to kind of like, I think you got to come to pit road and run your strategy just like the race is going to be run a full 200 laps.
But no matter what, I'm not going to come to pit road. I have to come there for the fuel. I want to run it right to the last lap that I can run. And again, for a lot of these guys, Sprague and Riggs and Nemechek, that's not that many laps away.
It really isn't. And I think, you brought it up earlier in the day, and I told you this is going to be exactly what's going to happen. The guys who can get on and off pit road the fastest are going to be in the best position to win this race. Hendrick has always been known for their fast pit crews. Be interested to see how Joe Nemechek's guys respond to it and whether or not they play follow the leader, and whether, Nemechek will come first or whether Jack Sprague will come first, and how the rest of these guys will play it out. And the 21 car may be the guy in the worst position of them all if a green flag stop comes in.
All right, we are two laps from halfway. Thanks, Jeff. Let's get an update from the third place cars pit, Scott Riggs. Here's Matt.
Mike, Harold Holly, Scott Riggs, crew chief, keeps coaching and cheering him on, telling him we're only now one lap away from halfway. It's money time, but Riggs is telling his crew chief Holly that his car is tight, and he gets Darrell Waltrip's least favorite term, the dreaded arrow push, when he gets up close to the 87.
All right, fans on their feet, the NASCAR officials on their feet as we've hit halfway as the leaders come fast.
You got to give a credit to this racetrack, though. Eddie Gossage, his people, jet dryers, tire monsters.
I've never seen the like
track back. But I'm telling you, here's the guy that's on the move, Matt Kenseth. This is a battle with Jason Keller in the 57 for seventh. And what I like about him, with these skies darkening up, he can probably run about 15 laps further than a lot of these guys because he pitted and topped off on lap 65.
And we know he has a fast pit crew.
And how many times have we seen adversity turn into advantage?
Well, and what I also like about his strategy, if we do go the distance, he can do this race on one more stop. They can run about 65 or 70 laps. These guys that are going to have to pit in about 10 laps, they're going to have to make an extra shot should this race go green all the way.
Hey, the way the race is going right now, everybody's kind of settled down. I mean, there's a lot of close racing, but everybody's minding their manners pretty well at this point.
We talked early about vortex theory, whether you believe in it or not, Darrell and I do, that these cars, the heat they generate whirling around this racetrack, create a vortex that keeps the rain away. And as a race fan, I want to believe that.
I do too. Well, the reason I believe it is because that's what NASCAR told me.
Now, Riggs is a second and a half back of this duo, Sprague and Nemechek, the leaders. Let's update the weather. There's the weather radar, and we are somewhere right about there.
Pretty scattered, pretty broken. I mean, we might get a raindrop or two, but I don't think we got anything serious. Jeff, you got, what do you think?
Well, what I'm seeing, Darrell, is this broken stuff you see right in here. It's kind of like breaking up right in this area here and here. And it seems like, looking around outside the door, I've been outside a couple times, looking at how the wind's working. And it looks to me it's going to possibly miss us. If you look one more time, these opening areas right in here, this is what is going around the racetrack. And I really believe that this is going to be what these crews are watching. They're seeing how this is kind of breaking up, and you got to figure the race is going to go the duration rather than get hit by another rainstorm.
Let's see what Larry Sprinkle things.
Well, here. And just to further educate my fans out there, green means rain, and Darrell, there was no vortex in the 92 Southern 500. Trust me, the rains did come.
Larry Sprinkle is not Larry McReynolds. He's a Charlotte weatherman.
No, actually,
by
he is.
That name.
He is.
Imagine
Larry
that.
Is the hippy dippy yep. weatherman.
Coming up on Pit Stops. We're at 105 laps. This race will be official today. Winston Cup tomorrow. We'll be right back.
The NASCAR Busch Series on Fox, presented by Old Spice, is brought to you by Old Spice, the deodorant of NASCAR.
As our boat sinks slowly in the west and the sun drifts away from the shore, night falls in Texas, but we're still racing. Casey Kane spun coming out of turn number four to bring out this fourth caution of the evening.
I think he was trying to get on pit lane, look like, and he just was going way too fast. He gets her woed up right here. It's already been in an accident. He almost misses the end of pit lane.
Of course, you're trying to get down to 45 miles an hour before you get to those clocking segments, just way too fast.
And that's why we're under caution, because he is out in the drink. Without a life preserver, can't get out of the grass. So Casey's going to be held two laps.
That's one for spinning on pit road and one for tearing up the man's grass.
here's our Old Spice race summary after 108 laps. Again, we've only had two leaders. Jeff Green, the pole sitter, led 42 laps. Jack Sprague has been out front ever since. 27 cars are still on the lead lap, and we're working the fourth caution. Officially, Darrell, the rule is that he passed the speed zone line on pit road going too fast.
Yep.
And backwards.
And backwards.
Yeah.
he was in big trouble. He got in big trouble and just trying to get into pits, man. That's all I was trying to do.
The leaders will be coming to pit road now. The first time by, the pit road was closed because Casey Kane, there was a wrecker out there trying to get him off pit road. Now everybody comes to pit road here with about 92 laps to go.
Yeah, Kansas, the whole crowd, Sue.
Dick Bergeron.
Brian Patty has told his crew four tires and gas, 3,500 RPM in second gear as Joe Nemechek comes down pit road, running in second spot, looking for his first ever win at Texas. The car is good. They're going to make no changes at all to it. That.
Nick, on the bottom of your screen, Scott Riggs, the rookie, stops a little short because he doesn't want to get blocked in by the 60. He had an open pit behind him. They're going to make a wedge adjustment because he said he had a pretty bad push to Steve.
Matt, one round of wedge in the right rear for Jack Sprague. He had a half a pound in the right front. Good stop, 18.1 second.
Sprague will be the second car to come off pit road.
And Jeff Purvis in that group, they were the first car off pit road, but they changed two tires, only trying to get that track position, watching the skies. Maybe not bad strategy.
No, I think it's a great move for him. You know, he's running pretty decent. He's running 10th. He comes down pit road, gets two tires. He's out leading the race. But these guys did the job, 24 guys. I mean, that's a great stop, and it's just, they've been doing that all day.
And it's two stops that they've got their guy out front of as far as everybody that changed four
times. And Larry, I mean, how many times have you seen it? I don't care what team it is. When you're running up front, your pit crew performs better.
And when they perform better, you feel good about
everybody
it.
Everybody gets pumped up.
Darrell, that's got to be a big boost to a driver to know that you're not losing time on pit road, that either you're gaining or you're holding your own.
You want those attaboys as a driver, but you want to give them back to the crew when they give you service like that.
Fourth caution of the day here, 109 laps complete, 91 to go in Texas.
Welcome back to the Texas Motor Speedway NASCAR Busch Series presented by Old Spice. And it started after a 3.5 hour plus rain delay. Harvick and Wallace having a little fun. Some of the drivers killing time. The Winston Cup happy hour was canceled once they got to racing in the Busch race. Stuart Kirby, lap two, problems spinning and out of the race. Lap 46 from the in-car camera of Lyndon Amick. spinning, the Spider-Man trademark, and oh, what a tangled web he weaves here. Caught in that, Michael Waltrip, the 99 car squeezed and nowhere to go, flips over, but they put out the fire, and Michael Waltrip okay as he walks away from that. Just moments ago, Jeff Purvis passing Mike Wallace for the lead as we are more than officially halfway through this race, but it still is a little bit damp. The rain is holding off for now. Jeff Hammond, how is the track, and which cars and drivers will fare better over the last 90 or so laps?
Well, it looks so far now that it maybe wind up being a race between Jack Sprague and possibly Jeff Green. Let's don't rule out the fact that we're looking at Joe Nemechek, who is probably eager to make a win right now because, you know, he's just lost his Winston Cup ride. All these guys are in great position. I think the track has really come in well, and the rubber's, you know, got down really good all day. And we're getting ready to get set, I think, for a really great finish here.
Yeah, under our fourth caution, it's, more than 5 hours of racing and delay. When you put it all together, about 100,000 fans have hung in there. The lights are on here at Texas Motor Speedway. Let's now go down trackside to our Matt Yocum. Matt?
Chris, under that caution, Randy Goss, the crew chief for Greg Biffle, in the pit next to the 10 pit of Scott Riggs and his crew chief, Harold Holly. Goss came over and you two had a conversation, Harold. What was the topic?
Well, we're trying to stop a little bit short because Greg keeps getting blocked in up there. We tried to stop short that time, and we did. We stopped a whole lot shorter than we did the first time. Guys on the next quick Ford Taurus crew are just doing an awesome job. Our tire laid down there, and it got stood back up. Greg had kind of had to dodge it and knock the tire over the pits. We got it back down, so it was plenty safe, but it just kind of held Greg up a little bit, and I wanted to apologize to him because we're trying to work together here.
Now, rain is in the forecast. What's your strategy?
Just keep the car from getting tight right now. I'm planning on running all the laps, so NASCAR's going to do all they can do to get this thing in. I've seen him run this thing till 10 o'clock at night, so I'm planning on running all the laps. So I'm just concentrating on trying to get my car good for a full fuel run. It's starting to tighten up after about 40 laps, so we made 2.5 times the adjustment we made the first time. Maybe this will get us a little further into a fuel run before we have to do something else.
Riggs restarts from fourth. Steve?
Matt, with Butch Hilton, crew chief on the 21. Butch, you had a little bit of a problem on the first stop. How was your second stop, and what adjustments did you make to the car?
The Rockwell Automation Chevrolet is really good. Track position's critical. The aero push deal, you know, all that. We're trying real hard to get back up to the front. Guys had a nice pit stop right there, but we were even off of them. Saw a lot of guys get two tires right there. It's going to be interesting to see how it goes. We're just trying to keep up with the racetrack, Steve. It's changing a lot, you know, because of the rain washing the rubber off of it. Got a little loose on that stop. At the end of the deal, it started tightening back up again. So we went ahead and freed the car up a little bit more there and see what happens.
All right, thanks. Let's go to Dick Bergeron.
With Brian Patty, no adjustments on that last stop. The car good enough to win?
We think so. I mean, we're just riding, trying to save right fronts. I mean, if you're sitting in Infield Care Center, you can't win this race. So, and Joe knows that, and I know that. And we're just doing the best we can. I mean, the guys in the pit stops are doing great. Motor's running good. Just worried about this rain. I don't know if it's going to go the full deal, and it might change how we approach this race a little bit.
Okay, to Matty.
Dick, they've waved off the restart, and Bobby Leslie, crew chief for the 29 car, you took on two tires, rolling the dice?
Yeah, we wanted some track position there. We come for gas the last time, was hoping to beat them on some mileage, and it didn't happen, so now we try to get some track position, and hopefully if the rain holds off, we can do something. If not, that's the way it goes.
Well, that paid off. He gained about 15 spots under that yellow, guys.
And I want to pick up on Brian Patty. You know, we heard him early in the race talk about the right front tire, taking care of it. We heard him just then mention the right front tire. And the reason for that is Joe was testing at Dover last year, and they were up there with the Busch car, and he blew a right front tire. And it took Joe out of competition for several weeks. So I know that that's one of the reasons why they keep talking about the infield care center and the right front tire.
And you know, these guys changing two tires, Darrell, I mean, they had almost 40 laps on those left side tires. That's a lot of laps. That's about two-thirds of a stop. What you really have to be careful sometimes when you put fresh rights with that many laps on the lefts, the car will push. So you almost have to make built-in adjustments to either take wedge out or something with air pressure to free the car up, even though your car's maybe being good, just changing those right side tires.
Yeah, and we could see it in the lap times too, Larry. I mean, they were up running 29 and a half second laps. That's 2.5 seconds slower than they qualified. And so the pace had really, really fallen off. Of course, they were working traffic as well. But I think the tires were giving up, too.
That helps that right front tire a little slower speeds, Jeff Hammond.
Yeah, Larry Durrell, one of the guys I've been, you know, kind of keeping tabs on is Matt Kenseth. We talked about him earlier. Had a very good race car, had a little problem in the pits, fell way back, had to work his way back up through the field. He was a big benefactor this last caution because he was way behind as far as on track distance from the leader. He was able now to get a lot closer, and I think he's got one of those kind of cars that can get around some of his lap traffic. He might have something for the leader.
Hey, Jeff, if we're going here, we're 114 laps, and we're not going green this time by. So if we get to about 120 laps and we haven't gone green yet, guess what I'm thinking? I'm going to come back down pit lane. I'm going to top my car up, and I'm going to try to run 80 laps.
That's exactly what you should be doing, Darrell. Exactly. And I wouldn't put it past that 60 car to be one of the first ones to come down pit road if that's the case.
I mean, I know y'all said 65 to 70 laps, but that's based on, you know, worst-case scenario.
And that's based on faster speeds they were turning yesterday
exactly.
In final practice.
So if I can get four or five more laps under caution here, I'm coming in.
Well, the light sprinkle has turned into a heavy rain.
Never
the fans
mind.
Are running for cover.
And the 37 car may have made the move of the year, Dick Bergeron.
Terry Shirley, crew chief, did you know this rain was coming when you gave your guy just two tires and put him in the lead?
Well, I'm hoping so, Dick. I tell you, it's looking pretty good right there. I mean, Jeff's done a good job today. Car's been pretty decent, a little tied off over there, but we thought let's gamble on this thing and see what happens. And man, I hope it rains.
You got a rain dance in you, Terry?
Yes, I do.
This is the first time all year these guys have led a race. It is raining harder and harder. They got a chance to win this thing.
Well, it is raining, and that's good news. Now he needs to go find out where the generator is that keeps the lights.
Yeah, right.
Well, he gets something done to that.
He played for track position.
Yeah.
And they got that. The rain is for Jeff Purvis an unexpected bonus.
And they're bringing them down pit road, which signifies once they get them all to pit road, we probably are going to have a red flag condition. They're going to halt the race here.
Yeah, as hard as it's raining, it's tough to even go around the track at pace lap speeds and keep these cars with slick tires under control.
Yeah, and then in a race like this, when something like this happens, it's what you call highway robbery. because he goes steal one.
For every hero, there's a zero. And poor Mike Wallace, he stayed out on the track during the yellow and led lap 110, but then he came into the pits, and now he's 27th.
Oh, man. He didn't have as good a weatherman as we have up here. See, that's the problem. But, you know, I've been seeing it. There's some lightning fly back over off the right over here.
Let me exonerate Mike Wallace here. He came in the next lap because NASCAR said we're going to give one to go.
One to go.
And he was, getting
okay,
close
we're going
fueling
racing.
Tires, so you
now,
have to.
Right. He had to get gas because they were going to go back, and they waved off one to go. Then after a couple of laps, they gave two to go. They waved that off, and now it's raining again.
And we have what we call lost this racetrack.
Oh, yeah,
it's already
yeah. This is as hard as it's rained all day, and it looks like it's set in for a while. Back in Tennessee, we call this a frog strangler.
This is not the what Ken Squire used to say, the clearing off shower,
no,
as they say in Vermont.
Yeah.
You call it a what?
Frog strangler.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I learn more from you every day. I don't know if I keep up with it all. I need to start me a book.
Hey, you got that notebook over there. Keep writing.
Frog strangler. I got that.
Yeah, let's take a break. What do you say?
No, let's crank it up.
Oh, let's get out of here.
We'll be right back. You are still watching NASCAR on Fox.
Welcome back live on Fox at the Texas Motor Speedway where the rain is coming down. Stick around. Coming up later, new episodes of Cops and America's Most Wanted. That's tonight following the race that may never end. It's like a bad cold won't go away. NASCAR Busch Series presented by Old Spice. As the rain continues to fall, the lights are on. And what's that old expression? Come hell or high water, we're going to get this race in.
And we're going to stay here until we get it done.
And there's the high water. And I guess Jeff Hammond, are they deciding right now? Nice umbrella there, Roush yeah. Racing. Are they deciding right now that it may be time to call this thing?
I think right now, the way the grandstands look, unfortunately, I think everyone has said, hey, I think it's time to throw in the towel if you've got a dry one, that is. And it's one of those deals. Weather here is very unpredictable. I talked about it earlier. We had some gaps, wind blowing really hard. Came back in and got us.
Our weatherman, Larry McReynolds, has been on the case. And, of course, the weather, we did the best we could to kind of guide the audience all the way through this. At least there was some racing. And I want to just get your thoughts real quick on that last series. They made a good point, Mike Choi, about, you know, Kenny Wallace waiting. And after they were ready to go, one lap to go, he decides to pit. And Jeff
Purvis, Mike.
Mike Wallace. Kenny Wallace. And so he, in a sense, gets kind of left out in the cold here.
Yeah, that's one of those bad break situations. Everybody's always trying to play the odds, and he felt like, well, I need to come get gas. And if he stayed out probably one more lap, he'd be the winner right now.
All right, and interesting watching the reaction between still Jimmy Spencer and Jack Sprague. If we go back a couple of weeks, you know, as was pointed out in the broadcast, a little bit of a rivalry going on there. You're supposed to forget about these things, but we saw Sprague earlier, as was pointed out on the broadcast, kind of get Jimmy to be in a trouble spot. And Jimmy seems somewhat satisfied that at least Jack Sprague was not leading the race at this point.
I think he was. And at the same time, he probably walked over and said, I think Darrell and Larry did a really good job of saying, hey, you know, you kind of got me on that one right there. I owe you one. Yeah,
look, and this is moments ago. That's so you go. Jimmy Spencer saying to Jeffrey, I'm glad you're ahead and not Jack Sprague. We're just interpreting that. We're guessing. There you go. Thumbs up.
They got him. Jimmy's, but like I said, Jimmy's a good sport about a lot of that stuff. He's done it to a few guys, and again, this time it was done to him. So
well, I mean, we had Kurt Busch with us, who spent a couple of hours earlier in the day. The two of them talked and reflected back to their Winston Cup race in Bristol. Said, "Hey, that's just part of racing. You don't carry that over. Sometimes you can." Let's go down trackside, and Dick Burgert is standing by on the raindrops or out of the raindrops, Dick.
And it is absolutely pouring down here. Margot Turner is Jeff Purvis' fiance. Yesterday was her birthday. What did you ask your husband to be for your birthday?
I told him all I wanted was the trophy, and he said, I will do the best I can to get it for you. So
far, so good. It's not done yet.
So good. So we're just keep praying for rain. We've prayed for it not to rain all day, and now I'm praying, please keep raining.
Okay, you can surely see the emotion on Margot's face. She bad wants this win.
Okay. Thanks, Dick. It was the lap 107 when Casey Kane spun into the pits. The leaders pitted. Jack Sprague was leading at the time. Mike Wallace didn't pit, led to one lap. Then he did pit when they thought they were ready to go. And Jeff Purvis taking the lead on the 111th lap after a two-tire pit stop. And he is the leader as we stand at the moment and the rain falling at Texas Motor Speedway.
I think that's the one thing we love about our sport more than anything else is we have an opportunity sometimes to expect the unexpected all the time. And once again, it wasn't a quick pit stop. It was a little bit of strategy that kind of played out along with Mother Nature.
Well, we made fun of Larry McReynolds for taping the Weather Channel in his days as a crew chief, but it is part of, as he pointed out here, that you obviously have to worry about tires, track conditions, and the weather when you decide when to pit. And the race is official. It's over. So
there it is.
And we just got the word, Jeff Purvis, 43 years old from Clarksville, Tennessee.
He's his crew chief.
His fourth career Busch Series win, and his best finish, the Busch Series finish this season, had been 18th at Rockingham, but he's the winner.
And that's one thing you want to point out there. Jeff Purvis did a great job, but an outstanding call by his crew chief right there got him this win today.
Yep, part of a team effort in and out of the raindrops. Let's go upstairs. Mike Joy, Larry McReynolds, and Darrell Waldron.
Well, Jeff Purvis led only six laps, but they were the right six. It's his fourth career Busch Series win, his best finish at Texas previously, 10th. 2 years ago, he won at Richmond and Michigan in 96. He won last year at Pikes Peak, led 121 laps that day.
But you know what? Let's just make one thing clear here. His strategy didn't have anything to do with this rain. I thought it was a great call for him. He was about 10th when he came in, took two tires. He's seen all day long. If you get out front, you can stay out front. So we don't know that he couldn't have held these cats off and won this race anyway.
Really don't know how your car be out front versus you've been in traffic all day long.
Well, the runner-up
will
be Jack Sprague, and Matt is with him.
Well, Jack, what is it about this place, Texas?
I'm not real sure. man, I'll tell you what, the guys gave me a great car, same car I had in Vegas. And that Zero Chevrolet was awesome. You know, we talked about the two-tire deal, but if it wouldn't have rained, you know, we were in position, we had a shot at winning this race. So we had to do what we did, and we still almost beat them out, but we didn't. But it's our best finish. I mean, but damn, you know, led the most laps. Got Spencer madder at me for something. I guess I did something else to him. Who knows?
We tried to talk to him. What did he say?
He said, forget it. It's over. He walked by my car as we was getting out, and he told me that I was going to hate the rest of the year racing with him. I never touched him. I don't know what his deal is, so oh well.
Do you think that he felt like maybe you might have juked him a little bit on the restart?
Well, they said the double red line. I'm not going to that double red line. I've been black flag for that before. He went before the line. That's his deal. I mean, I didn't do nothing to him, so way it goes.
Well, Jack Sprague, so many good runs here in the trucks at Texas, but not the win. And today, another great run. He still comes away second.
And it's Sprague's first top five finish of the season.
And that's my story, and I'm sticking to
it. That's right. Jeff Purvis is the winner. Sprague is second. Joe Nemechek third, all in Chevrolets. Rookie Scott Riggs is the rookie of the race, and he's the first Ford in fourth.
Look at all those Chevrolets.
Pole sitter Jeff Green, then Kevin Harvick, another two-tire stop.
Exactly. Went from 21st to 6th. But Jeff Green, he's probably going to take the points lead, but he won't be at Nashville next week because Jay Sauter will be driving that car.
And Sprague will move up to second. That later, but here are the rest of the finishing order.
Today, and another Hendrick car, Ricky Hendrick car.
27 cars finished on the lead lap.
Larry Foyt, good day for him. AJ got him home safe.
And these cars laps down or out of the race when the rain came and the checkered flag flew.
Mike Wallace finished 27th, last car on the lead lap. And he came in there, like you said, leading the race with when they gave one to go.
I believe, is this not the first win for this team?
Kevin Grubb ever win in
never won a race. Now, this is the same team that had the teammate Casey Atwood driving. That particular team won some races.
Okay.
But
this bunch of Kentucky guys. Just bump around Bowling Green,
second,
Kentucky.
Jeff, congratulations, buddy. Good job.
Thanks. Second win for that bunch. Steve Burns.
Thanks, Mike. Congratulations on a win. That was a tricky one, but it counts as a win.
I passed him on the last lap. You know, I was going fast. No. Hey, this team deserves that win. The first pit stop, we gained a lot of spots on our pitting, and then that last call, Terry Shirley decided to put on two tires, and you know, I wasn't going to question him. I thought it was a great, great call, and you know, I was praying for that rain myself.
All right, congratulations, Jeff.
Thanks.
All right. Bring it back to me now.
All right, Jeff Purvis leading just six laps.